Good afternoon. It's good to hear. Yeah. Let me introduce myself. I come in from Kyiv, from the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. My institute is Institute of Semiconductor Physics, named after Lashkarov, one of the founders. And I will talk today on surface plasmon resonance sensing with application in biological objects and for health control. In this picture, you can see our building where we are working in our institution. Almost 20 years ago, it was Institute of Cybernetics, but now we have five different buildings where different labs and different departments are located, and you can go from one to another in 2-3 minutes. It's more close than even here. Our institution, we have four different directions of investigation. First one is physics of interaction processes between electromagnetic radiation and matter, physics of low-dimensional systems, micro and nanoelectronics, optoelectronics and solar power engineering, where exactly I'm working with, and semiconductor materials, science and sensor systems is also related, and we have department that collaborate with each other. And we have following divisions: division of optoelectronics, theoretical physics division, division of semiconductor optics, division of photoelectronics, surface physics and microelectronics, division of structural and analysis of semiconductor materials and systems, division on physical and technological problems of semiconductor infrared techniques, and division of technologies and materials of sensor techniques. Unfortunately, we are from developing country, but we have some new equipments that is known as common used equipment among Academy of Sciences. For example, our institute have modern atomic force microscopy, Raman spectroscopy, good equipment. Then the newest one, X-ray research. Another institution has some femtosecond laser, and we cooperate with each other, and we can use all the institution equipment, not only our institute, but all the institutes of National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. So a few words about our National Academy of Sciences. It's quite a big structure in Ukraine. We have almost 174 institutions where employed around 40,000 people, 40,000 scientists. This Academy of Science was founded in 1918. And simultaneously, in this year, this person known as Boris Paton, he is president of National Academy of Sciences. He was also born in 1918, and still president of our academy since 1858. So next year will be 60-year anniversary as he chair this National Academy of Sciences, and will be also 100-year anniversary of our National Academy of Science and for this president. So everybody is invited to celebrate, to participate. We have a number of conferences, number of journals to publish, to exchange ideas, to cooperate with each other. And I will continue now about science. So in my talk, I will discuss shortly nature of plasmonics, plasmon excitation conditions, theoretical description of surface plasmon resonance, excitation configuration and coupling of light by different methods, type of modulation, sensitivity and ways to its increasing for different types of modulation, it's different. Influence of surface microgeometry on resonant peak position, application of surface plasmon resonance method for biosensing, surface plasmon resonant detector based on CD disk format and plastic substrate, and introduction of Plasmon 6 device for experimental session that part of you, group number 4, 5, 6 already done this experiment, and group number 1, 2, and 3 will continue, will do this experiment tomorrow evening. Yes. So let's start from total internal reflection of light. This lecture will be just beginning to plasmonics, so it's very easily things, but somebody that is not familiar with this technique will shortly learn this, but if you want to go deeper to this science, we can collaborate, we can use our, your techniques, your samples, our samples, and in the future. But just only beginning introduction to plasmonics. So if you have a laser, okay, if you have light penetrate from optically less dense medium, you just have refracted light and reflected light, and probably a little bit absorption. But if your light propagates from optically more dense medium, in the interface of these two mediums, we have also refracted light, reflected light, and that's all. But if we use Snell's law, in special condition, in the limit case, in case of reflected light has 90 degree, in this case, sine of 90 degree will be equal to 1. And for example, if this is air, let's consider refractive index also equal 1. In this case, we can calculate beta. And starting from this angle, we will have total internal reflection. And all the angles more exceed this beta, all the light will be reflected fully. But if you put a small, it doesn't matter. If you put some medium on the top of the surface, it's better to put any conductive materials. It can be gold, it can be silver, it can be any metal and also semiconductor. Any material that has free electron, any conductive material, even graphene. In this case, light reflects, 100% of light usually reflects from the interface. But this light also excites evanescent wave propagating across the interface of two medium. If you have conductive materials, it consists of carrier, for example, free electrons. And this light, with its own frequency, excites free electrons in this material. In this case, we excite evanescent wave, and part of the full intensity coming to this interface is lost. Is not lost, but it's propagated here, and we can view a dip in the reflected light because part of this intensity come across the interface. And also this evanescent wave has decay, exponential decay. With this distance. So slowly we will start to continue with surface plasmon sensing. So let's start from definitions, few definitions. So what is plasmonics and what is plasmon? This is quantum of collective electron oscillation in conductive materials, or in another words, electron density waves. Surface plasmon resonance, this is evanescent wave, is resonant excitation of plasmons in the conductive material between two media with different refractive indexes. For example, glass and dielectric or liquid. They have two different refractive indexes, and surface plasmon is exciting just on the interface. Surface plasmon polariton is electromagnetic wave that travel along a material dielectric or metal-air interface. This term explains that we have involves both charge motion and the in the metal and electromagnetic waves in the air or dielectric. And localized surface plasmon resonance is the result of the confinement of surface plasmon on nanoparticle, conductive nanoparticle of size of comparable to the wavelength or even less. Also, now is very popular such structures as ferrum 203, known as magnetite. It oftenly used as to excite magnetic resonance, also known as plasmon resonance, but in another words is magnetic because it is supported by increased magnetic permittivity of this material, magnetite. So about nature of plasmonics. In any metal we have from Drude theory, we have its plasma frequency of metal. If our light penetrate to the metal, to the interface with dielectric air or any other material with the refractive index N to the metal, this light excite volume plasmon. It has own frequency. For different material, it differs, but approximately it in order of 10 in 16 power radians per second. So if light penetrates to the interface of two medium, we have these evanescent waves. And this wave decays with distance from the top of this surface. This is very important because we have limitation on materials we can sense. For example, we cannot measure refraction index of very big molecules. We have a limitation. And the sensitivity decays from the surface. So if we measure just on the surface some gas or liquids, it will be good result. But if our detection system is quite far, for example, 100 nanometers or up to 1 microns, the sensitivity would be much, much less. So the necessary condition to excite surface plasmon. We have a light with its K vector penetrating to the interface of two medium, and we excite surface plasmon along the interface of two mediums with its own K vector. So the projection of K vector of incident light depends on dielectric permittivity. It's known as refraction index of prism, for example, and sine theta. Theta is the incidence angle of light beam coming to the interface. So projection of this K vector on this plane will be this relation. And projection of K vector to our plane should be equal to the K vector of evanescent wave, known as surface plasmon. Surface plasmon is related with the electric permittivity of metal that is on the interface. It can be gold, it can be silver, cuprum, it can be semiconductor. And also with dielectric permittivity of metal, of dielectric. Dielectric that we are sensing on the surface. So X component of incident photons wave vector should be close to the value of surface plasmon resonant wave vector. Some problems? The next condition to excite surface plasmon is epsilon of dielectric and epsilon of metal should have opposite signs. In this case, surface plasmon cannot interact with incident light coming to metal film, and excitation of surface plasmon can be supported by total internal reflection using prism, diffractive grating, or waveguide. But it can be done only with p-polarized light, only TM mode. Why? Because hybrid states of non-uniform surface waves and electron plasma in metal can be excited only by p-polarized light, e-vector, electrical vector of light beam, is located in incident plane XZ. As you can see, this is the incident plane of p-polarized light. H-vector in this case is directed along y-axis. Generation of surface charges requires electric field in both X and Z components. Otherwise, you cannot excite free electrons on the top of the metal coated prism. I already told you about Drude theory of free electrons in metals. This is the formula. You can calculate dielectric permittivity of metal using frequency, dependent from frequency of light. Dielectric permittivity, absorption. So in finally, this formula, epsilon is equal to 1 minus omega plasmon over omega in square. So this is plasma, volume plasma frequency of metals. It depends on electron concentration. This is the constant. Electron charge, mass of electron, and epsilon zero. I will try to show you short animation. Okay, this is the model of free electron in metals. So you can consider the surface of metallic films. This is the electrons that have average travel path, the average frequency of collision between each other and also own frequency of oscillation. Here you can see animation of excited surface plasmon evanescent wave. So you can see this is orientation of charges in the material that excited by incident light beam, laser beam or spectral beam, depends on different condition of excitation. I will follow this a little bit later. Okay, how we can describe penetration of light to many layer system theoretically? I will show you two approaches. First one is very easy. I think that many of you are familiar with this technique. For example, persons that are doing polarization microscopy, the person that is related with optical design. It's almost the similar technique. It's a little bit different, but the same approach. So you have many layer structure. Here is the beginning of our material. First, second, M layer is the last, and now we have a beam going outside the system. And of course, we have reflected light here, and we have transmitted light here. And part of light, of course, will be absorbed here, but we have also reflection at the interface of each layers. Reflection back and forward in any direction, so we have final transition and final reflection of this system. So we can describe this by easy approach, by formulas. We can build a matrix. In this case, E plus and E minus is coordinates of electric field of light beam, amplitude. So here, E plus and E minus is electric field of light at the first layer, at the interface of first layer coming to our system. E plus and E minus M plus 1 is the coordinates, is the electric field amplitude that exceed our system, that transmit our system. But not only transmit, E plus is transmitted light going in forward direction, and E minus is reflected light. So this is the direction of propagation of our beams. For calculation of these reflection coefficients can be taken from here, we can calculate S matrix, scattering matrix. Scattering matrix consists on interface matrix and propagation matrix. And now I will shortly describe you, maybe somebody of you used old techniques of calculation lenses. Now we have many modern programs, but if you have some lens, propagation of beam is very easy to build, you know, but if we have a number of lenses, some elements with different refractive index, it can be quite difficult to make graphically how this beam propagates. So one known method is to use matrix. Matrix that give coordinates of beam at the interface, and matrix that show how beam propagates through the system. So translation matrix and interface matrix. The same system is here, but the difference is only with the radius of this. Here we have spherical symmetry, but in our case we have flat structures. Flat structures, now we consider only flat structures. So scattering matrix consists on interface matrix and propagation matrix. Interface matrix can be calculated using Fresnel coefficient of reflected light in each interface and transmitted light at each interface using Fresnel relation. Known Fresnel relation is, you can see here. So if you can computer, you can program very easily. You can also try to do by yourself manually. Okay, and L matrix is propagation matrix. It describes absorption of light in each layer. Of course, this propagation matrix, absorption of light, depends on absorption coefficient of each layer and its refractive index, because they are related, as usual. And to build the scattering matrix, you can multiply each of these matrix starting from M plus 1 layer and back to first one. Each of these matrix, as you can see, has two rank, second rank. After multiplying, the scattering matrix will be also second rank. In this case, reflection of many layer structure can be calculated using appropriate elements of matrix of scattering S. So this is reflection will be S21 over S11 in square. So this and this element. S12 and S22 is related with another phenomena. Okay, using this system, I show many layer system. Here is theoretical calculation. Here is theoretical calculation of reflectance, deep inner reflectance spectra for silver, its first curvature, and gold, thin films, too. You can see that silver has more narrow band than gold. And they also shifted in angular position. So the minimum of silver fin is related to 60 and approximately half degree. And the gold is related approximately 63 degrees in this calculated spectra. This is not experimental, this is calculated one. The second quantum approach to calculate position reflectance spectra of our plasmonic materials. You can use this approach is different from the previous one by taking into account polarization and surface concentration of molecular layer on our metallic film. By applying Green function as photon propagator, we can write this equation. Photon propagator is a Green function that gives us the probability of traveling a charge between position 1 and position 2 in a known time interval. Plus and minus is, for illustration, I will show. Plus and minus is propagation direction. So we have here plus area, positive area, negative area. So propagation plus 1 is this direction. Propagation is minus plus this direction. Plus plus is reflection. Minus minus is such reflection. So considering electrical vector equal to reflectance multiply on the first electrical vector on the first layer, the total equation for reflected light can be written as this very big formula. You can easily calculate this if you know surface concentration of molecules, if you can build photon propagator, permittivity of molecules in each layer, electric field that come into our system inside, and reflection, you can calculate known all these values. So as I told, here is the illustration of our negative and positive area. And taking into account this formula I showed you before, we can understand that total reflection will be the sum of the general simple Fresnel reflection and reflection caused by polarization and concentration of molecular layer, this one. So if you don't consider this, if you use matrix method, you will lose this part. It's very important. Okay, if you have not flat structure, if you have materials, metal materials, that is not flat, but island structure, localized surface plasmon, so if you have nanoparticles, metal nanoparticles, not even metal, it can be semiconductor. In this case, you can use well-known simple, not very simple, but it's simple, Mi theory to describe these materials. Mi theory is scattering of light by spherical particles, by spherical nanoparticles. And if you know, there are three cases. If our particles less wavelength, if they are comparable, and the next, and the third part, if wavelength is much more than the average dimension of nanoparticle. So the dielectric function, real and imaginary part of the dielectric function, can be calculated by this equation using plasmon volume plasmon frequency. Tau bulk, it's the constant, is 9.3 to 10 in minus 15 power seconds. Relaxation time. Fermi speed, as written here. You can calculate effective relaxation time. And based on this calculated equation, you can calculate refractive index of the material and absorption coefficient of this material using the real and imaginary part of dielectric permittivity. Here are a few configurations how to couple light by surface plasmon method. So the first one is common used Kretschmann method. You have seen this on our lab. It's a prism, but we have another type of prism. This is a prism, so here is penetrate a light, laser, for example. Okay, it doesn't matter. A light that reflects and excite a surface plasmon that exponentially decays with the distance. So here we can observe this direction reflected light, and if we have a surface plasmon, it will be lost of some reflection coefficient. If we observe a deep at the reflectance spectra, it will be intensity of our plasmon, and we can calculate position and the width, average width of this band. The next is, okay, two-layer Kretschmann configuration. It differs by adding one more layer. And another one is Otto configuration. The difference between Kretschmann and Otto is the metal film is after the prism. So we have a liquid. So in first configuration, we measure our liquid or gas on the surface of this metal film. In Otto configuration, our materials to be measured is located between prism and metal. Here, we have excited plasmon resonant peak, but for Kretschmann configuration, the sensitivity is much better than Otto. That's why this method is more popular than this one. Also, we have some other different methods for exciting surface plasmon. It's scanning near field optical microscopy probe. So we have a probe. It excites metallic, yes, very thin. It excites near field here in the interface, and we can have the surface plasmon. This is method using diffraction grating for excite surface plasmon resonant, and using diffraction on surface features, surface nanoparticles. Independently from this case, there are three known methods for coupling light to the surface plasmon. First one, as I told you, it's prism method, so light coming from outside to prism. Then from optically more dense medium, we have total internal reflection and excitation of surface plasmon here. And this surface plasmon is related with the refraction index of this medium. And in this case, we can measure this refractive index very precisely. So the accuracy of this method is around 5 digits after comma. But this is not the most huge, not the most accurate method. Accuracy can be more higher. This is waveguide method. This is waveguide method to excite in surface plasmon. So we have just waveguide, and we can deposit thin metallic films or island structure of nanoparticles, metal nanoparticles, and attach small cuvette and measure a refractive index of this cuvette just on the top of this waveguide. This is one of the most popular method because you don't need expensive prisma, and you can make this device very small and easy to use outside in field. in any condition outside lab. And diffraction grating. So you can excite plasmon by diffraction grating and the light penetrate into the system by diffraction on these futures. Sometimes diffractive method is overcome this prisma method because the band of the reflectance band of plasmon is more narrow. So the full width of this spectral reflectance curve has less dimension. So you can calculate refraction index more precisely. Okay, we have four type of modulation for calculation of refractive index of plasmons. First one is common used angular modulation. This is excitation by monochromatic wave by changing the incident angle. So as you, some of you see the lab, we can scan the angle and look where this plasmon exciting highly. So this surface plasmon observed as a dip in the angular spectrum of reflected light, and our sensor output is the incident angle yielding the strongest coupling. The second popular method is spectral method by wavelength modulation. We can use modulated, collimated polychromatic light. You can use monochromator or prism or diffractive grating to make spectral, to make spectra from the white light. And this surface plasmon will be observed as deep in the wavelength spectrum of reflected light. And sensor output will be the wavelength yielding the strongest coupling. And some original methods as intensity modulation. You use single wavelength, you use single angle, and you just modulate intensity. So you increase or decrease intensity of light and look when surface plasmon will be the highest. And one of the most precise method is phase modulation. So you can use excitation by shift of phase of the light wave at single incidence angle and wavelength. So the single angles, the single wavelength, but you change the phase and look when surface plasmon will be bigger according related with the phase. Each of these methods has its own sensitivity. So here in the table you can look approximately sensitivity of each method of modulation. So for intensity modulation, our resolution of RIU is 10 in minus 5. For angular spectroscopy, it's possible to take almost 10 in minus 7, but you can use additional things to compensate some noises and some other phenomena. For frequency spectroscopy, we have 10 in minus 6, and the better resolution we have for fast shift measurement. But what is not good for this method, we have very low dynamic range of measurement. So fast phase shift can be measured only at 10 in minus 4 power order. So that's why we have measurements. We have a limitation for this method. But for resolution, it's the best one. Okay. Here you can compare for localized surface plasmon resonance, different geometry of nanostructures. Here the sensitivity for nanorhombs, nanospheres, nanopyramids, and needles structures. So sensitivity can be calculated as argument of each of these methods. Okay, for spectral modulation, A will be lambda. So S, spectral sensitivity, will be delta lambda over delta N. So you can see that the best sensitivity can be observed for needle structure. Little bit less for nanopyramids, and the lowest one for nanospheres. Nanorhombs has the medium value. But total sensitivity is not exactly a thing that we can operate. It's better to operate but by figure of merit. Can be calculated as this sensitivity over full width of this curve at the middle height. And you can compare that this, the most sensitive structure for needles, has the lowest figure of merit here, because the bend has big width. And that's why is better to use for more precise measurements, is better results can be shown for nanopyramids. Yes. Here is 40 nanometers per RIU, but here is the maximal value. Okay, ways to increase sensitivity. If we have angular modulation, we can add additional diffractive grating. We can stabilize temperature and noise, so our band will be more narrow. For wavelength modulation, we can use Fourier spectrometers and other techniques, multi-channel sensing, and thus we can go up to or down to 2 at 10 in minus 7 RIU. For intensity modulation, we can use two light sources with little bit different wavelength. So thus we can get this sensitivity. For phase modulation, we can use, first one is interference pattern analysis. So you just look on the diffractive interference picture and estimate this modulation. So you can analyze this interference pattern and improve your result by some additional optical elements. You can use ellipsometry by analyzing S and P polarized light and make difference appropriate calculation. In this way, you can get this sensitivity, almost 10 in minus 8 power RIU. And you can use heterodynes if you have a different wavelength. So the interaction will give frequency a few orders less, and you can detect this phase by general phase detectors. And universal methods that can be used for every type of modulation is use dielectric nanocoatings, using graphene to increase sensitivity, using nanoparticles, metallic nanoparticles, use magnetite, yes, for increased magnetic permittivity. Here you can compare influence of forms of molecules on SPR resonance. So some of biological molecules are known as elliptical form, but orientation of this ellipse can be extended in horizontal, in a vertical direction, or extended in horizontal direction. So we can compare surface plasmon resonance response in relation with orientation of such elliptical molecules. On this graph, you can see the reflectance spectra, surface plasmon resonance peaks that are related to different type of molecules. So the first one is the empty surface. So no molecules, only sensing element, only chip. So we can first curve have the angle at 62.747. If we have, shortened molecules is this B, okay. So second is extended in horizontal direction. So our angle shift to the higher degrees. This is the second curve. Three, we have extended molecules in vertical direction. So we have extend our theta even more. And number four is extended molecules but the factor is little bit less than here. This is the relation between A and B of ellipse. And you can see the maximal angle of our surface plasmon resonant peak. And here is another situation. We have calculated surface plasmons resonance dependence of structure of molecular film consists from both vertically extended and horizontally extended molecules. So first one is only, okay, first is only extended molecules, vertically extended molecules. We have that here. And second one is half of extended in horizontal direction and half is extended in vertical direction. So as you can see, if you have a mixture of two molecules, our angle of surface plasmon shifts a little bit. Okay, one of the methods to influence on surface resonant peak to make tuning, you can use elastic substrate. In this picture, you can see and compare nanoparticle structure on solid substrate and the same on elastic substrate. For elastic substrate can be used a polymer, polydimethyl siloxan, known as PDMS. So after deposition and including nanoparticles in this matrix, you can make this material, okay, you can make wider, shorter, you can modify, and your peak of your plasmon resonance will shift, and the curve will change its shape. So this is the method you can negotiate and you can influence on your system by many, much more parameters than only spectral or angular modulation. Okay, here is the scheme of biological analysis for a simple scheme that is known as direct detection of system, sandwich detection format, as you can see here, competitive detection format, and inhibition detection format. So it's related in the position of analyte, of antibody, antigen, its interaction, and so on. Now I will shortly, briefly explain you the method and the device developed in our institution. It's the surface plasmon resonance sensor based on disk format. So you can use just a known CD-ROM or DVD-ROM device, and you can use old factory that producing CD and DVD disk. Using the same material, you can produce a sensor. Multi-element sensor. You can put here over 50 samples to measure in one way. So here's the general scheme of this detector. This is optical element. So light, laser light of this CD-ROM comes to the plastic sensor. Okay, to produce this sensor, of course, we should coat it by some of metals. For example, gold, maybe silver. Depends on your situation. But of course, gold has less reactivity with chemicals. So gold is preferred. But this gold will be deposited on a plastic substrate, not glass. And it works. We have patent of Ukraine of this technology, and this device is underway to commercialization. So I will show you more detail, the scheme of this device. So here we have such elements. This is part of disk. Here, laser collimated light using polarizer. So light comes here. Here we have diffractive elements, then mirror outside, and our element with cuvette. Here you can put your liquid that is necessary to measure, and then light comes to detector. So here's single wavelength, single angle, but you can make holes, make detectors for any case you need to measure. You can measure just refractive index, you can measure chemical reaction, you can measure anything you want by use up to 100 channels simultaneously. Okay, here's the general scheme of device you have seen in our lab, SPR6 device, surface plasmon resonance, that is using angular modulation. And as you can see, here is the configuration of prism is made by special method that light comes from the laser, reflects at the same direction. So you don't need to rotate laser and detector as in ellipsometers, as in triangle prism. This prism has better configuration. You can just rotate your prism and light coming to this prism will reflect at the same angle and come to detector for measurement. So group first, second, and three can enjoy this experiment tomorrow. It will be, I think, more easier and more quick detection. We prepared this, and anybody that bring samples with you can find our guys, Gleb and Maxim, to measure own samples using this device. We are here until Saturday, so everybody is invited. This is the characteristics of this surface plasmon resonance, plasmon 6 refractometer. So as you can see, is the refractive index can be measured. This is accuracy of this device is 5 × 10⁻⁵ power, but of course this is without thermal stabilization box. In Ukraine we have thermal stabilization box, but it's enough tech space, so we didn't bring this. It can be even improved. So this is the detection limit variation resolution, angular resolution, measurement time, laser, excited laser, power, weight. So, and it's also comes with software built especially for this series of devices. Okay, I think for today is enough. So for conclusion, I'd like to say that surface plasmon resonance method allow to detect changes of refraction index up to 10⁻⁸ power refractive units. This is good for measurement of low concentration solution. Various configuration available depends on your needs and your availability of materials. It's possible to detect non-organic and also organic and liquid solution, as well as gas solution, gas and liquid solutions, including cytes, red blood cells, viruses, proteins, etc. This is non-expensive technology, as you have seen before from CellMIG company. Device is very easy to build, and the cost is, I think, is even less than our device. So the technology is not expensive, possibility to use multi-channel detection, and effectivity of CD disk format biosensor that can be used for big, big data analysis of this, our materials. In the end of my talk, I would like to thank ICTP, the International Center for Theoretical Physics, for invitation, and for my colleagues, Maria Luisa Calva, Humberto Cabrera, Nicoleta Tosa, and Alberto Diaspro. Special thanks to local organizers, Johnny Emela and Micho Danailov, and for our secretary, Federica Del Conte. Special thanks to Ukraine International Airlines for giving us tickets for fuel. Just for fuel, really. They are our sponsor, and for all Ukrainian team, they give us, I just make calculations, so it's exactly for this kind of, very appreciate this kind of service. And to our society, our sponsors, SPE, the International Society for Optical Engineering, Optical Society of America, International Commission of Optics, that today evening will be a special reception after awards ceremony, and Optics Sweden Life Science Society. Here I can shortly invite you to submit paper to our journal. We have a tradition, each institute of our, almost each institute of our academy have own journal. As you have seen, 174 institution. It means that more than 100 journals we have each institution published, but it's different topics. It can be mathematics, geology, and so on. But here in Ukraine, according to National Library of Ukraine, we have the most citation among Ukraine. And also we use cross-reference data. We start to make DOI number and cross-reference data. So due to statistics, we have first and second number for citation in Ukraine. So I invite you who is interested to submit paper here because it's open access and it's free. No any payment for submission, for distribution, quarterly issues per year. And the general time before submission and acceptance is from 3 to 5 months. Occasionally, it can be only 1 month sometimes. So this is the journal webpage, journal SPQEO, means semiconductor physics, quantum electronics, optoelectronics. So we have, as I told, open access, free publication. We presented in 32 research databases of EBSCO. We have quick processing, double blind peer review system. We have DOI and cross-reference for numbers per year. We have in-time publication and hope to submit this year for Scopus and Thomson Reuters. Yes, yes. So this is, I think, enough. Thank you.